till from heaven you came running. There was mercy in your eyes to fulfill the law and prophets. To a virgin came the word from a throne of endless glory to a cradle in the dirt. If you know it, sing it out together with us. Praise the Father, praise the Son. Praise the Father, praise the Son, praise the Spirit, three in one. God of glory, majesty, praise forever to the King of Kings. We praise you, was moved for good, for the Lamb had conquered death, and the dead rose from their tombs, and the angels stood in awe for the souls of all who'd come to the Father are restored, and the Church of Christ was.
About the fact that my Father has everything I need. Whatever the situation you're facing, the Lord has the answer. If you'll rest in Him, if you'll trust upon his name, everything you need can be found in the Father. Thank you, Jesus. Praise your name.
Look at the flowers in all of their beauty. I don't have to wonder, you know what you're doing. So why would I worry at all? 'Cause you're faithful to supply everything I need, everything I need. My Father has it, my Father has it. Every single time the Lord will provide. My Father has it, my Father has it.
Call upon him today. Thank you.
Look at the sparrow lacking for nothing. The fear of tomorrow, what it will bring. If I have you, I have enough. Your love will satisfy everything I need, everything I need. I know my Father has it, my Father has it. Every single time the Lord will provide. My Father has it, my Father has it. Everything
has it. If you have a need today, come on, stretch out your hand. Call upon the name of the Lord. You can be set free today. He can break the chains that hold you. Thank you, Lord. Come on, seek first.
Seek first the kingdom and its treasures. Everything else it will be added. All that I'm needed. Well, I know the Lord will provide.
Come on, he's not empty-handed.
Well, I know my God's not empty-handed. 'Cause he gives us blessings upon blessings. I'm still believing. I know the Lord will provide.
Come on, seek him first.
Seek first the
is everything I need. Everything I need, I know my Father has it. My Father has it.
Come on, I know he already told you.
Every single time.
But if you put your trust in him today, God will move.
My Father has it.
And I know he said it already, but if you got a need, could you lift a hand if you're comfortable? And just make this song your prayer today. Begin to remind yourself, God's got my back. He's got everything that I need. And he's alive today. He wants to bless you. Come on, just worship him.
My Father has it. My Father. Seek first the kingdom and its treasures. Everything else will be added. All that I need, yeah.
Lord, we worship you today. We praise you. We give you all the honor and we give you all the glory, for you alone are worthy of it. We are grateful today, God, that you have everything that we need. The world tries to convince us otherwise, but God, we know the truth. We know that you sent your Son to die for us. And on the third day, he rose again so that we could have everlasting life with you. And it's through your Son today, God, that we come before you and ask that you would provide for your people. There are those in here today, God, that raised their hand and said, I have a need. I need God to touch me. And so, God, we pray by your strength and by your mercy and by your power that you would today heal the sick, mend the brokenhearted, break chains of addiction, comfort those who are hurting, those who are lost today, God. Soften hearts in this place. People who've built up walls. God, we pray by your strength and your power that you would move today. And we do, God, thank you for your Son. On this Easter Sunday, we are grateful today that we can come to you through your Son and know that he's alive today. He's alive and he's well and he hears us and he answers. And so we pray that you would do exactly that. We thank you, God, for all that you're doing already in this service, for all that you did in first service. We pray, God, that as the word goes forth, that the seed would fall on good soil, that you'd hide your servant behind your word, and that you'd bless and move in each and every heart and life represented here, those watching online. We are truly, truly grateful today, God, for all that you are doing in our midst and for all that you are going to continue to do. And we'll give you all the praise and all the honor and all the glory, for you alone are worthy of it all. And it's in Jesus' name that we pray these things. And everybody said, amen, 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 amen. My name's Luke. I'm one of the pastors here. I just want to take a moment and welcome you. If you are new, if this is your first time joining us for any type of service, obviously it's a little different in here. But as you exit today, on the back walls, out in the foyer, there are QR codes. If you're a visitor, we'd love for you to take the time and just scan that QR code. We'd love to know who you are, where you're from. There's a gift bag that they have for you out there, and just some things that we'd love to give you just to say thank you for being here at New Life. There is a youth table out there. If you're a teenager in here and you'd like to know more about our Wednesday night youth services, there's a table out there for you. There's also a table out there for our young adults. If you're 18 to 30s,
and interested in joining our young adults group, there's a table out there that let you know about all sorts of things that are happening. I have to tell you about one more thing, but before I do, if there are any seats in your row at all, if you could either squeeze in or hold up a hand and just let our ushers know how many you have. There were about 30 or 40 empty seats in first service, and we are being told that there's about 40 or 50 people out there waiting to get in to get a seat. God is doing incredible things. And I was going to say here at New Life, but we know this is Trumbull High. But today, it's New Life. Today, this is God's house, and we're filling it, and we're excited for all that he's doing. So if there is a seat in between you, I see one there. I see a couple. So just if there is a seat, please let them know. And then on your way out today, the last thing that I want to let you know about is on your way out today, you'll receive one of these cards. Some of you got it on the way in. It's just a reminder. Next week, we'll be back at our normal campus. If you're new, it's like 2 minutes away. We'll be back. Three services. I already know none of you are coming to the 8 a.m. I know it. So what I need all of you to do is to talk amongst yourselves and to split between the 9:45 and the 11:30, okay? Figure it out. Three services next week. Don't miss out on all that God is doing. We're praying he's going to fill all three. Amen? And then on the back of that card is just an introduction to our new series that we're going to be starting next week. We are starting a series called Plain and Simple. We believe as a church, as a pastoral staff, that following Christ should not be something overly complicated. Jesus didn't intend for it to be something that confuses you or gets you all twisted, trying to figure out, So we're going to start a series next week called Plain and Simple. We're going to simply teach you, how do I read the Bible? How do I pray? How do I do the things that God has called me to do? The simple, basic things that are part of being in a relationship with him. How do I do those things? And so if you're new to church, you've been coming 100 years, or this is your first time here, join us next week at any of our three services for our new series that we're going to start. And then can you do me one more favor, because you sat down while I was talking? It's rude. Could you stand up? Could you stand up and turn around and just welcome somebody to church today? Welcome somebody to New Life.
Bless the name of the Lord. Well, bless the name of the Lord. I don't know about the rest of you, but man, I'm enjoying today. I've already been to church once. I got saved. I gave my life to the Lord this morning in the first service. It was absolutely incredible. And I've been told I'm supposed to pause for a moment because they got people that are trying to get in here. And what an incredible problem to have. And as we said, we had over 1,200 people here in first service, and there's more people than that here right now, and they're trying to scramble and find seats. I'm looking, but I don't see any, and I'm sure by now if you had any, you'd have given them up. And so I appreciate that. Bless the Lord. If anybody's willing to have somebody sit on their lap. No, it's not that kind of church. I think we're going to get down to business. My name is Mark Evans, and I am another one of the pastors here. And it is my absolute privilege and honor to welcome you to Resurrection Sunday 2024. Welcome to Resurrection Sunday. And you'll hear me use that term quite a bit this morning. We're actually finishing up a series today that we've been in for 5 weeks. This is our fifth week. We don't normally do that. Easter is usually a standalone message. But when we looked at the series we were in, I just felt like, man, that last We've been looking at red letter living. We've been looking at the words in the Bible that are the words of Jesus. And in some Bible versions or translations, they're actually printed in red. And so we looked at the words of Jesus in red. And we've marched through four of them. And it came to Easter Sunday. And I said, no. That fifth thing that Jesus says, we're going to preach that on Sunday, Easter Sunday. But for those of you, because we're going to read some other portion of Scripture today, but I don't want anybody going home today and they said, did they mention it was Easter? Happy Resurrection Sunday. Listen to me. Let me get this one page out of the way, and it's a part of my introduction, but I got to let you have it. Listen to me. The core of our hope is the resurrection. The core of our hope. Without the resurrection, we have no hope. I love Good Friday. I love the cross. I love that Jesus was willing to sacrifice his life and to spill his blood so that our sins could be washed away. And I hope you don't take this as sacrilegious, but it's the truth of Scripture. If Jesus came and died and did not rise from the dead, we would have no hope. I'm thrilled that he sacrificed his life, that he was willing to be that spotless Lamb of God. But we lose sight sometimes, even in the church, that without the resurrection, we have no hope. But because he lives, we are promised life. Hallelujah. The resurrection of Jesus was the beginning of God's new project of forgiveness and redemption. There was a plan before Jesus. It was called the law, but it didn't work. And so God sent his only son to live amongst us a sinless life, to sacrifice his body, to give up the ghost and to die, be put into a tomb. But 3 days later, he rose from the dead. And it's the beginning of this new plan of God's forgiveness and redemption. Now, according to Wikipedia, and I trust it foolishly, but according to Google and according to Wikipedia, I checked this just yesterday, there are in the world today 4,000 religions. 4,000 major religions. 85% of the world's population identifies with one of those 4,000 religions and one of those religious groups. And I mean no disrespect to anyone here that has a different religion or a different group that you want to identify with, but I've got some startling sad news for you today. There is only one resurrected Savior. And there are 4,000 religions where man tries to reach God, because that's what religion is. Religion is a set of rules and stipulations that make man feel good enough about himself or herself that they will stand before God and say, well, I was very religious. But God isn't interested in religion. He wants to have a relationship with us. And so if you've got a religion today, I'm happy for you. It might make you a better person. It might make you a better human being. But it won't get you into heaven, because you've got to come through the resurrected Savior. He is the only way, and he is that resurrected Savior of mankind. So again, I'm not trying to be offensive, but I need to tell you from the outset, listen, Buddha is gone, Muhammad is gone, Confucius is gone, Marxism has died. Every leader and every founder of every world religion has come and died, but none have risen from the grave, only Jesus. Listen, I'm going to shout it until Jesus calls me home. The tomb is empty. Glory, hallelujah. I've been there. Now, if you've ever been to the Middle East and you've ever been blessed enough to go to Jerusalem and go visit the tomb where they say Jesus was buried, and different tour guides have different ones. It depends who you know and what bus you're on. They take you to a tomb. This is the tomb where Jesus, they all look the same. But I went to one. And I'm going to tell you, when I went there, it was empty. And I don't know if it was the one that Jesus was buried in, but I can tell you this on the authority of God's word. The tomb where they laid our Savior is empty this morning. It was empty 3 days after the crucifixion. The tomb is empty, but our hearts are filled. Our hearts are filled today with hope, with healing, with forgiveness, with the promise of heaven. Why? Because we serve the resurrected Savior of the world. Hallelujah. Not because of your religion. Not because you go to New Life. Not because you got christened when you were a baby. But because of the Christ who gave his life and 3 days later rose from the dead. Glory. Hallelujah. Would you give the risen Savior a round of applause this morning? Would you give the King of Kings a round of applause? Glory, glory, glory. Hallelujah. Our Savior is risen on Resurrection Sunday. There you go. I got all the people who came. Because some of you are just here today. You haven't been here since last Easter. And if you went home without me talking about Easter, you would say, I came for Easter, and he didn't talk about it. Well, I'm glad you're here for Resurrection Sunday. But I want to talk to you about the fifth thing that Jesus said that is recorded of him in Scripture. We've looked at four of them, and I'm not here to recap, but we got a lot of visitors today. The first thing Jesus said when he was 12 years of age was what? I must be about my Father's business. And he was 12 years of age, and what was he teaching? That the most important thing is the kingdom of God. And then we learned the second week, what did he say to John the Baptist? Permit it now, baptize me. Although you don't think you're worthy, baptize me. I must do it for righteousness. And we learned that we have to be about God's kingdom. We have to make the kingdom the first priority in our lives. But secondly, we must seek righteousness. We got to try to live right. Say amen. Amen. And then we learned that Jesus was tempted by Lucifer himself in the wilderness. And what did Jesus say? It is written. We learned that once we seek the kingdom, once we seek after righteousness, the greatest weapon that we possess against the enemy of our souls is the written word of God. Which is why, watch this segue for a commercial, ready? Which is why next Sunday, if you join us for one of our new three service times and our new series called Plain and Simple, you will come next Sunday and you will listen to a sermon, which is probably the simplest sermon I've ever preached, maybe other than this morning's. But next Sunday morning, the title of our message will simply be this: How to Read the Bible. We're going to show you next week how to open the Bible, how to read the Bible, how to understand the Bible, how to get something out of God's Word. Why? Because the Word of God is the greatest weapon you have to live in this dark and sinful world. And then last week, Luke helped us look and find out that Jesus said, follow me and I'll make you fishers of men. That if we have found the Christ, if we have been about the Father's business, that we must begin to share what we have with other people. This is why somebody invited you today, because they want to share with you what Christ has done for them. Would you say amen to that? Amen. In John's gospel, we read the fifth thing that Jesus is recorded as saying. And when I say it, some of you are going to say, wait, that's the same as last week, but hold on. It says the next day, Jesus decided to go into Galilee, and he found Philip and said to him, follow me. Wait, that's what Luke preached last week. No, wait, we're going to dig a little deeper today. Luke discovered and showed us last week that Jesus said, follow me because I want to make you fishers of men. Today we're going to find that Jesus is calling everyone, everywhere, everybody on the planet to abandon who they are and turn and follow him personally. And that's what I want to talk to you about today, following Jesus personally. He said, follow me as my disciple, accepting me as your master and teacher, and walking the same path of life that I walk. It says, now Philip was from Bethsaida, the city of Andrew and Peter. Philip found Nathanael and told him, we have found the one Moses in the law and also the prophets wrote about, Jesus from Nazareth, the son of Joseph, according to public record. Nathanael's got quite an answer, doesn't he? Nathanael answered, can any good thing come out of Bridgeport? Can any good thing come out of Trumbull? See, I'm answering the question or asking it very flippantly. I don't have time to delve into it today, but I will explain it in a moment. But Nathaniel is not asking a disparaging question. He's asking a theological question. He understands some of the Old Testament prophecy. He has questions. And so you'll find out later that Jesus is not angry with him about this question. He's not saying it in a negative way. He's simply asking a theological question. Can any good come out of Nazareth? Philip replied, come and see. Come and see. Jesus saw Nathanael coming towards him and said of him, here is an Israelite indeed, a true descendant of Jacob, in whom there is no guile, nor deceit, nor duplicity. Could you imagine if you met Jesus and while you're 10 feet away, he said, here's a guy who's a great guy. There's no guile in him. There's no deceit in him. He's an Israelite indeed. There's no duplicity in him. I don't know about you, but I would cringe to meet Jesus. Certainly a long time ago in my life, because I think far away he would have said, there's Mark Evans. This guy's got more guile and more duplicity. He compliments Nathanael for who he is as a human being. And Nathanael said to him, how do you know these things about me? Because we've never met. Jesus answered, before Philip came and called you, while you were still under the fig tree, I saw you. Woo! It'd be pretty cool, wouldn't it, if someone said to you, hey, I heard you're a nice guy and everything. How do you know that? We've never met. Well, yesterday, while you were at your sister's house having lunch and you were eating that sponge cake and drinking that coffee with two sugars in it, you'd be like, this guy bugging my phone. This guy got a camera in my sister's house. He tells Nathanael exactly where he was. Look at the response. Nathanael answered, Rabbi! Teacher, you are the Son of God. You are the King of Israel. Jesus replied, because I said to you that I saw you under the fig tree, do you believe me? You will see greater things than this, Nathanael. And Jesus goes on to tell him, you're going to see angels descending and ascending and the kingdom of God revealed on planet Earth. You're going to see miracles. You're going to see all these incredible things. You think me telling you that I knew where you were an hour and a half ago is cool? Wait till you see what the kingdom is going to bring. My sermon this morning can be encapsulated in one slide. And I know when I'm done reading it, some of you will say, well, can we go home? No. But listen to me. Here's my sermon in a capsule today. Listen, nothing in this world is more important than knowing Jesus. Nothing is more life-changing than knowing Jesus. Nothing is more life-transforming, sin-destroying, hell-escaping, heaven-securing than knowing how to follow Jesus. It will change everything about who you are and what you do in life. And if you're a visitor here today, if you're watching on live stream and you're not a follower of Jesus, oh, you believe in him, you're religious, but you're not a follower of Jesus, I would encourage you, talk to the people who brought you to church today. Don't take my word for it. Talk to them when you have lunch today. Ask them, what was it like when you started following Jesus? And they'll tell you, woo, you got an hour? Hold on. I was an idiot and now I'm wise. I was bad and now I'm good. I was lost and now I'm found. Knowing Jesus makes all the difference. So I'm going to make a statement, and when I make it, it's going to sound like, well, yeah, duh. But I'm shocked that in the American church today, you have to make these kind of statements. Listen, Jesus is the answer and Jesus is Christianity. You say, well, of course he is. Yeah. But in the American church, in the American culture today, we've almost taken Jesus out. See, you can go to church every week and you can be religious, even in an evangelical setting, and yet never hear Jesus preached or him crucified or him resurrected. And we need to get back to a place where we don't just put Christ back in Christmas, but we put him back into our faith. And understand that without Christ, we are lost. The answer is Jesus, not New Life, not your religion, not my religion. The answer is Jesus. It is not the church. It is Christ that we preach. And there is a subtle movement in the world that has even crept into the church where Christ is kind of removed. I mentioned a moment ago. Listen, the world doesn't care if, and they'll help you celebrate happy holidays. They'll let you celebrate. You can put up a tree. You can give gifts. You can do everything you want. Just don't say Merry Christmas. Why? Because the devil knows and the world knows if you can take Christ out of the holiday, it just becomes another day. I was embarrassed and ashamed and prayed early this morning when I discovered that our own government, the White House, they made a statement today. It doesn't matter. That's another whole issue and another whole subject. And if you don't know about that, just Google it. Shocking what they said today was instead of Easter. But I also read and discovered that our White House put out a document several weeks ago that said we can celebrate the spring season, but when we decorate the White House, when we have egg hunts, when we do all these things, there must be no religious symbols. Not one egg can have a cross on it. Why? Because it's okay to celebrate as long as you don't celebrate Christ. There is a removal, a desire to remove Christ from our religion. And I will tell you this today, that without Christ, we have no hope. And Christ must be the center. This is why he said, follow me. It's the title of my message today. Follow me. He didn't say, follow your gut. Follow this good guy. Follow your church. Follow Pastor Mark. Oh, don't. You'll get lost. And I drive too fast, apparently, so you can't follow me. But follow this one. Follow that one. No, what did Jesus say? Unashamedly, Jesus said, follow me. Follow me. I'll show you God. Follow me. Listen, Christianity only happens through an encounter with Christ, through our surrender of self and a new decision to follow another. We live in a culture today, even in the American church, where it's easy to get people to become church attenders if we make church so easy and we hide some of the truth. I'm not a very good salesman because I tell people too much. But you know that you'd rather deal with an honest salesman than a crooked salesman. And I want you to know today, I want you to know this morning that Christianity only happens through an encounter with Christ. It doesn't happen through an encounter with your church or with someone else. You have to meet Jesus to be changed by Jesus. It is about surrender and a new decision. Conversion only comes through conviction. We must see our need of a Savior. We must see that we are lost. Spectators do not always become followers. Seekers always find what they seek. And the American church today, in many ways, has become filled with spectators who want some form of religion to make their lives better or their financial future better or to get the blessings or the help of God without ever, ever having an encounter with Jesus Christ. And it is only Jesus who saves and sets us free. Would you say amen? Amen? One more statement. Listen, no one becomes a Christian without wanting it. Some realize their need quickly, some over time. The time doesn't matter, but you must seek the truth. You're not going to wake up one day a follower of Jesus Christ. You must seek it. You must go after it. You must look for Jesus. And in doing that, I promise you, you will find him. Nathanael answered him, can any good come out of Bridgeport? Can any good come out of Nazareth? I told you, he wasn't being flippant. He was asking a theological question. And there is a theological debate to be had about whether or not any good thing can come out of Nazareth. There certainly were answers that Philip could have got into with him and had some long conversation. But I want you to see what I want you to see what Philip did. Nathanael wanted a discussion. He wanted an argument. And what did his friend say? Dude, I don't have all the answers. I don't know what to tell you. Just do this. Come and see. Come and see. Come and see. And my call to you today as a body of people watching on live stream here in this auditorium is this. Stop chasing after what you're chasing after. Stop looking for new life to answer all your problems. Stop thinking that some pastor or some priest or some pope has all the answers. Come and see the Christ that was resurrected from the grave. Come and see Jesus and you will find what you are looking for. So my message this morning is not full of intellectual reasons. I meet people sometimes who want to debate and argue with me. And I don't do it. I refuse to do it. I'll tell you why. Because most people are smarter than me. And I might lose. And I don't have all the answers. People come sometimes because you're a pastor. And I said it in first service. And I was joking, but I didn't lie about the number. I had four or five people, I think it was in first service, right before church, asked me a question in the back, walking along the aisle here. Pastor, I just have a question. And they're not little questions. They're huge questions. I had three in this service. So you're a better crowd. You're smarter than that first crowd. I got three. But they're usually questions like, Pastor, I know you're going up to preach to me, but just one quick question. The dinosaurs in the Bible, where do the dinosaurs end? Really? Now, I could have a huge conversation with you about dinosaurs. I believe in dinosaurs and I know when they existed. And I could have a huge intellectual, theological conversation with you about dinosaurs if you want. But at the end of that conversation, if you haven't met the Christ, all you know is more about Jurassic Park and not about the Savior. My goal today is not to intellectually convince you. I could make an argument intellectually with you. I could debate it with you. And my sermon is not full of emotional prompts or props. I just want to clearly preach, come and see. Come and see. There must be an encounter that you personally have with Jesus Christ for this to work. For you to become a follower of Christ, you have to meet him, not me. Does that make sense? If you've met Jesus and you know what I'm talking about, say amen. Amen. The psalmist David put it this way in Psalm 34. He said, open your mouth. Open your mouth. Look, some of you, I can see you doing it. You're actually doing it at me. I got people looking at me with their mouth open. Don't. Something will fly in there. I've reached that age when I open my mouth for sometimes the wrong time. I say things I shouldn't have. And I open my mouth sometimes when I can't see things. Have you reached that age when you can't see something? You're squinting? And you, I don't know why I can't see something. Like a light is going to go on in there or something or other, you know? Like the refrigerator or something. I want you to open your mouth, literally. The psalmist said, open your mouth. Why? Taste. And then what? Open your eyes and see that the Lord our God is good. How blessed, fortunate, prosperous, and favored by God is the man or woman who takes refuge in him. You see, taste comes before sight. What? Open your mouth, taste. And see that the Lord is good. If I said to you this morning, you might believe me because you know I like to eat. I mean, look at me. But if I said to you, listen, I know where you can get the best, put whatever you want. We all have our favorites, don't we? Like if I did a survey in here right now, what's your favorite pizza? We'd have war. Because you got yours. You got your place. That's our. That's if we get pizza, that's where we don't eat any. That's the pizza we get. Someone brings you a different pizza. No, I'm not. It's not. How good could it be? We got to go there. Our family has one. We like Domino's. So. Not really, but. The wonderful thing about Domino's is if it goes cold, you can always eat the box. It's the same. It's the same thing. It's like. Can eat it in the box, whatever. I shouldn't joke. Maybe there's someone here who likes Domino's. It's okay, whatever. If you like Domino's, that's great. But if I met a person who was a world-renowned food critic, articles written by him all around the world, he's eaten in 5-star Michelin restaurants all across the globe. And he's an expert on Italian food. And I said in front of him, listen, man, you're not going to believe it, but the best veal parmesan and a side of pasta that I've ever eaten in my whole life, and it's the best. There's nothing like it. No one in the world comes close. And it's in Shelton, Connecticut. The food critic would say, can any good thing come from Shelton? Well, now they have Chick-fil-A, so okay, Chick-fil-A. But can any good thing? You got to be kidding me. I've eaten in Rome. I've eaten in Paris. I've eaten in London. I've eaten that by the top chefs in the world. It can't possibly come close. And I could stand there and argue with him and debate. No, listen, you don't know what you're talking about. I'm telling you, I know you know more about food. But this food, we could go back and forth like that for an hour. And guess what? He's still not going to believe me until I put him in my car. And I take him over to Shelton, and I sit in my friend's restaurant, and I say, bring out the veal parmesan. Here, have a piece of that. And he cuts it, and he puts his fork in it, and he puts it in his mouth, and he drops the fork and goes, wow! That's the best veal parmesan I've ever eaten in my whole life. What's happened? He's tasted, and reason no longer matters. Listen, taste overshadows reason. In fact, I've got written here in my notes, you can't reason taste. Once you've tasted, someone can come to you and say, well, Jesus is this. Why does God allow that? And why does God do that? And why do sick people die? And why did my wife die? And why doesn't God heal those people? And why does he allow war? And why does God do this? And you can stand there and go, I don't know. I don't have answers for all that stuff. But all I know is this. 5 years ago, I tasted Jesus. And I'm telling you, it's still the best thing I've ever had. It's still the best. So I encourage you today, on this Resurrection Sunday, I'm going to pray for you before we go home today, but my whole message is geared around this one thing. I want to turn some of you into people who will seek after Jesus and try and taste and see. So listen to me. Start to read your Bible. Start to talk to him every day. Go to a house of God. Find yourself in the house of the Lord. Listen. You can't attend church, a good one. You can't read your Bible every day. You can't talk to him every day. And 6 months from now, I promise you. Yeah, but I don't know about this, and I don't know about this. I promise you, 6 months from now, you'll say, "Woo, that's the best Savior I've ever known." If you taste, you will see. That's my introduction. Here's my message. I'm almost done, I promise you. I just want to show you quickly the process, the value, and the result of that discovery. If you seek after him, I promise you these three things will begin to unfold. The first one is the process of the discovery. It says, the next day Jesus decided to go into Galilee, and he found Philip and said to him, follow me as my disciples. Now listen, we've established, I believe, that there must be a soul that is seeking after Jesus. As long as you're saying, I don't want to know God, I don't want to know Jesus, you're not going to find him. He's not going to show up one day. But if you'll seek him, what you'll find when you seek him, that you discover him, is that he was looking for you the whole time. It says the next day Jesus decided to go into Galilee, and what? He found Philip, and he knew where Nathanael were. Some of you have been on a journey. And the journey of life has taken you up and down through pain and sorrow and misery. But you're at a place in your life where you're saying, man, I want there to be more to life. There has to be more to this. And I'm telling you today, that process is the Holy Spirit tugging you and drawing you towards Jesus. And when you find him, we say it in church. I don't mind. Christian ease is a funny thing, but I meet people all the time to say, oh, I remember the day I found Jesus. I remember when I found him. It was 1967, and I found Jesus. And I always think to myself, man, God must have been so pleased with you that you found him. God had lost him, didn't know where he was, and you found him. We don't find Jesus. He finds us. And that's what you discover when you begin to seek him, is he was there all the time. He's waiting for you to move one step in his direction. And listen, God is drawing you. The process of drawing is different for different people. I'd love to tell you that every person I've ever met that has decided to follow and taste Jesus is a person who lived a great life, a happy life, and out of their joy and their bliss in life, they decided one day, I got to find Jesus. That's rarely the case. Most of you that are in here that found Jesus, you found him in the midst of your pain, in your brokenness, in your sorrow. You found him when everything else that you had counted on in life failed you. You found him at the end of divorce. You found him at the end of your addiction. You found him at the end of a loved one dying. You found him in your own illness. You found him in your own brokenness. And you came to a place where you said, I need something more. And someone said to you, come and see. But my brokenness, and I need counseling, and I need help. We'll worry about that later. Come and see. Come and see. Just come and see this Jesus, and you will be amazed. The process of the discovery is for some people fast, for some people slow. Some of you, quickly, someone spoke to you and you found Jesus. Others of you, this is your eighth Easter here, and you're still not a follower of Jesus. And your family keeps praying for you and believing. And for some of you, it may take a little longer. For me, it took a little while. I was an idiot. I guess that means you might be one as well, but I don't want you to be that. So listen, the process, the value of the discovery. Listen, Nathanael answered, Rabbi, you are the Son of God. You are the King of Israel. What's the value? The light goes on. Suddenly you know he is the Christ. All my doubts, all my fears, all my denials. No. He is the Christ. And in that value, in that discovery, there is forgiveness and freedom and fellowship. When you taste of Jesus, when you become a follower of him, what you'll find is instant forgiveness. All my sins in the past have been forgiven and washed in the blood of Jesus Christ. Now, for some of you, that's not really a big deal. You only had a little list like this. For some of us, we had like a scroll. Lots of sins, lots of mistakes. But the good news is that God has forgiven every one of them. And there's forgiveness in Christ today. Secondly, there's freedom. I walk in freedom today. I'm not worried about life. I'm not worried about what happens next. I'm not worried about eternity. Why? Because not only do I have freedom, I have fellowship. You're going to think me insane. Even some of you already thought I was insane just for this shirt. But you're going to think me insane today when I tell you that there's not a day in my life that goes by that I don't talk to God, my Heavenly Father. And I believe that he hears me. Why? Because I became a follower of Jesus. He opened up for me fellowship with my Heavenly Father. Thank you, Lord. And so every day I can talk to God. Not like some of you do where you just use his name when you bang your hand. No, I talk to him every day and I have fellowship with him. He's my Heavenly Father. Why? Because of Jesus and what he's done in my life. The process, the value, and finally, I close, the result of this discovery. It says, now Philip was from Bethesda, the city of Andrew and Peter. And it says, Philip found Nathanael and told him. It's an interesting part of the story for me because we have no recorded words that Philip says back to Jesus. Jesus says to him, follow me. What we do know is Philip doesn't say, well, what does that exactly mean? Do I have to join a church? Do I have to give up certain things? What is it you want me to give up? What is it I got to do? Do I got to start to dress different, talk to? Like, what does it mean to follow you? There's no questions. What we do know is that as soon as Jesus says, follow me, what we find is Philip trying to go other people to get them to come and follow Jesus. The result is what? Obedience, joy, fulfillment, proclamation, declaration. It's a discovery that he simply cannot keep to himself or keep silent about. Following Jesus is a personal decision, but it can never be a private decision. There are no secret agents for Jesus. If you're a follower of Jesus Christ, other people will know. Sometimes by what you say, but more importantly by what you do with your life. I've now become a follower of Jesus. And I used to go over here, but now I go over here. Why? Because I'm a follower of Jesus now. I'm following the leader. I'm not following what I want to do. I'm following what he wants me to do. I just want you to realize how brilliant one of your pastors is and how hard I study. And I want you to listen to the depth of this statement. This will tell you everything about my intellectual prowess. Those who aren't following Jesus aren't his followers. That's it. It's that simple. Followers follow, and those who don't follow aren't followers. To be a follower of Jesus means that I surrender to him and I come and see. I involve myself. I begin to taste. I begin to see. I commit myself to this. I want to follow him. Now listen, I told you I'm a terrible salesman. Watch, there are people right here, right now, that if I stopped right now and said, listen, who wants to be a follower of Jesus and who doesn't want to go to hell? Don't you love those appeals? I've made them. I mean, if you're talking to somebody logically, I get it. We meet people sometimes. I want to go to hell. That's where all my buddies are. Yeah, wait till you get there. I mean, if you say to somebody, listen, I'm going to ask you to make a choice. I'm a salesman. Would you like to spend eternity burning in a flame that never extinguishes, and you will be in absolute utter torment, screaming your lungs out for all of eternity? Or would you like to open door number one and go to heaven and walk on streets of gold? Nobody in their right mind is going to go, oh, I'm down for that hell stuff. That sounds awesome. I've always hated the winters up here in New England, and I've always wanted to be warm. Of course you'll choose heaven. But I'm telling you today, the choice is not heaven or hell. The choice is, will you follow Jesus? And if you'll follow him, woo! Now I promise you, you'll live a life that you never dreamed. I am such a fabulous human being because of Jesus. I am an incredible husband because of Jesus. I'm a better husband. I'm a better father. I'm a better human being because of Jesus. But that's not why I followed him. I followed him because of who he is. Following Jesus is not about how many rules you can keep or struggling to live a good life based on some moral compass. It's about surrender. It's about relationship. It's about obedience. It's about love. Religion is always about rules and regulations, and relationship is always about love. So I told you I'm a terrible salesman. Listen, the cost of following Jesus, the cost of discipleship, it's exactly the same for everybody. It's the same for my dad. It's the same for this gentleman here. It's the same for that young lady there. And it's the same for me. And here's the cost of following Jesus. You ready? Everything. You just got to surrender. Yeah, but I got these plans. I want to be. What about this and what about that? Stop. Shh, shh, shh. Come and see. Come and see. Taste and see that the Lord is good. Listen, I'm done. And that's a miracle. But my son said to me last week, he said, Dad, I noticed that sometimes you say, I'm done. And then you talk for like another 8 minutes. And then they gave me this timer that I'm supposed to, you know, I hit it. And my son said, Dad, the other thing I noticed now is that you, when you say I'm done, you hit the timer. But then you talk for another 8 minutes. And later you say, look, I was on time. And I say to him, taste and see. Come. I'm not going to argue with you. Just come and see. Just come and see. Just come and see. I've hit the button. Without Jesus, I'm just a sinner. With Jesus, I'm a saint. Without Jesus, I am empty. With him, I am full. Without Jesus, I am weak. And with him, I am strong. Without Jesus, I cannot. But with Jesus, I am more than able. Without Jesus, I'm already defeated. With Jesus, I am victorious. Because he is my all in all. And one day, I finally decided to stop doing what I wanted to do, and I decided to follow him. I didn't understand it all. I didn't get it all. But I read his word. I went to his house and I talked to him every day. And as my life progressed, I knew him more and more and more. And eventually I came to a place where one day I figured out that all the time I was looking for him, he was just standing there waiting in the corner of my life saying, come and see. Come and see. Follow me. And I'll show you incredible things I can do with your life. My life is nowhere where it should have been. I should not be standing here today preaching to 2,000 people in Trumbull. Can any good thing come out of Mark Evans? Come and see. Come and see. Come and see. What, Mark Evans? No. Come and see what the Lord has done. And if you'll follow him, I promise you, you will not be disappointed. Would you bow your head with us this morning? Every head bowed, every eye closed, all across this auditorium. Just quietly, reverently sit for one more minute while I close in prayer. And please just hold steady right there. And I'm going to ask you all across this auditorium, watching on live stream. Look, I'm not here today to embarrass you, harass you, or ask you to join a church. I'm here today to ask you this simple question. If what I have said makes a glimmer of sense, if there seems like there could be some hope in it, my prayer today is that you will make a decision to say, as of this day, as of resurrection 2024, I'm going to begin to try and follow Jesus. What about my past? And what about my other religion? And what about my old church? And what about... Just come and see. Just come and see. Come and see. Come and see. You will find the Savior of the world. You will find the hope you've been looking for. You'll find the peace you've been searching. Just come and see. He will not disappoint you. New Life will disappoint you. The church will disappoint you. I will disappoint you, but I promise you he will not. And if you're here this morning, all across this building, whether you've done it before and walked away, whether it's the very first time, if you're here today and you'll say, Mark, would you pray for me? I'm not going to embarrass you. I'm not going to ask you to stand up, come forward, nothing. But I'm asking you, would you like to decide to start following Jesus and see what happens? Would you lift your hand toward heaven? Just hold it there and I'll pray for you and we'll go home. My goodness, look at all these hands, too many to count. Just hold it there, hold it up. Don't be ashamed of it. Don't be ashamed. It's a private thing, but it's not a secret thing. I'm not ashamed to raise my hand today. I want to follow Jesus. Father, you see scores of hands today all across this building. And there are many more perhaps on live stream than in their living room or wherever they're at right now, God. And they're lifting a hand and saying, God, I don't get it. I don't understand it. I got a million questions. I got all kinds of issues. I need therapy. I need help. But I'm going to lay that all aside and I'm going to come and see. I'm going to taste and see. I'm going to come and follow Jesus. And I'm going to see what happens. I'm going to trust him at his word. God, I pray that you would seal these people into your kingdom right now. That by the power of your Holy Spirit, you would make their decision sound and solid. That when the devil lies to them tomorrow, that it was just emotion, it was the wrong choice, that they'll know in their heart, no, I'm going to read my Bible today. I'm going to go to church. I'm going to follow him. I'm going to talk to God today. I'm following him from here on in. Wherever that leads me. God, I pray that you would seal them in that kind of decision today. And I ask it in the name of Jesus. Would you say a big amen? Amen. Would you say a big amen? Amen? Give these people who raised their hand a round of applause this morning. Wait. Don't go. Don't leave. Don't get up and leave. Don't. I'm going to pray one more time. I want to give you one of these. Listen, if you raised your hand this morning, you said, I'm going to start following Jesus. We want to help you. We want to bless you. So we got this bag. It's heavy. It's got good stuff. Look, there's a $100 bill right in every. I see people raising their hand now. What? There's a beautiful mug in here. It says New Life on it because we want you to remember this day. There's a brand new Bible. There's some books and some booklets. There's all kinds of material that will help you begin to follow Jesus. We just want to give you the tools. Now, every one of you that raised your hand can get one of these. I got one for everybody. But on that table, there's a little card. All it says on it is, I decided to follow Jesus today. So just give us your name, an email, phone, whatever you want to give. Give address, phone, but we'd love to have your email. We'd love to send you an email and just, I'm not 10 of them. We're not that church. I'd love to send you an email that shows you how to take steps in your life that can help you follow after Jesus. Not join our church, not come to New Life, but follow Jesus. I'd love for you to get one of those. Make sure you stop on the way out, and we'll have one for everybody who's there, I promise you. Would you stand with us, and we'll pray as we dismiss. Heavenly Father, I thank you for these people that have come today. I thank you. God, I thank you. From the bottom of my heart, God, I thank you for what you have done in this place today. I thank you for every family. I ask your blessing now, God, on every home, every individual that's here. I pray that the rest of this day would be filled with fellowship and food, lots of food, some veal parmesan, and lots of food and lots of fellowship. But I pray, God, it will also be filled with conversation about what does it mean to really follow Jesus. And maybe we could share with each other what it means for us to follow you. And I pray now, God, your blessing over every home and every family. In the name of Jesus. And yes, I used the prayer to sneak out so that I could get to the door. So it's not magic. I'm just out here, and I'd love to say good morning to you and welcome, and thanks for being with us today.